I've had about 10 piercings in my life. So basically, I'm kind of like a pro at looking after piercings at this point. In the most recent case, I had an upper helix piercing that I got caught at an event when somebody was hugging me. And then the day after, it got really swollen, really inflamed. And it took me a while to actually work out, you know what? This piercing has actually gotten infected. So in this video, I'm going to go through how to actually care for your cartilage piercing, how to tell between an inflamed and infected piercing, and also how to tell the difference between a granuloma and a keloid scar that's developing around the piercing site. So cartilage piercings are very difficult because cartilage in itself has a very poor blood supply. When it is pierced through, it sees this as trauma and tries to heal the area as much as it can, but it's limited because the blood supply isn't coming there with all the nutrients to help it heal. And the healing process is quite dependent on different people. You might have friends who have had cartilage piercings who almost don't even bother about them and don't care about them so much, and they heal beautifully and there's no issues. Whereas you have gone out to get this one cartilage piercing that doesn't seem to want to settle down. And apart from the fact that you can't do anything specifically to change this difference, there are things that you can do to make sure that you look after your cartilage piercing properly. So I'm going to start off with something that I actually found quite difficult to do, and that is the litter method, which is the leave it the hell alone. And in simple terms, what this means is that once you have your piercing, you need to clean it with sterile saline solution twice a day. But besides that, you need to leave it completely alone. Don't touch it with your dirty hands. Don't twist the piercing. Don't pick the crust. And don't keep rubbing the area with other things such as rubbing alcohol and tea tree oil and things like that. The piercing really needs to be left to itself to do its healing process without being fiddled with and without having any infections from your hands added to it. And a side note, I know how difficult it is to hold yourself from picking that crust because it's so satisfying. Just sit there, there's a bit of crust, you really want to get your nail into it and just clean it up, because you're wondering when someone's looking at you, are they looking at the crust on my ear? So I know how tempting it is, because I also do it myself. But do as I say, not as I do. So let's say your piercing has become very inflamed. How do we tell between an inflamed and irritated piercing and an infected piercing? Well, there is no clear-cut black and white way of telling that it is infected, but some of the symptoms do give us some clues. So if you've bumped your piercing, or if you've got a new piercing, it's quite normal for it to be a little bit red, be slightly swollen, maybe can appear a bit white or even purpley color sometimes. But if the swelling is very severe, to the point where it's like almost engulfing the piercing because the swelling is coming around it, you start noticing that there is a discharge. Now, a watery sort of clear discharge is quite normal. That is part of the healing process. But if this discharge is like yellowy, green, and it's starting to get very gunky from the back or the front of the piercing, that's usually a good indication that things are starting to look like it's infected. And no matter how much sort of salt water rinses you do at home, it's not really going to cut it. In addition to it being red and having sort of discharge coming out of the ear, you might notice if you've got ears pierced that your glands around your neck is very sort of swollen and tender. So when my helix piercing was infected, the glands here were swollen and they were really tender when I pushed them down. In addition to that, you might feel some systemic features. So you might start feeling a bit feverish, as though you're coming on with a cold. You might feel shivery, and that is the body's reaction to the fact that it's fighting an infection. Now, if you have any of these signs, the best thing to do is to reach out to your doctor to get assessed in person. They might want to do some swabs if there's really sort of profuse discharge coming from the area. But the most likely thing is that you'll be put on some antibiotics of some sort. Now, if it's very small localized area, they might want to go for some antibiotic creams, but more than likely they'll give you oral antibiotics, so to take as tablets. Now, if you are wondering if it's inflamed or infected and you are unable to secure an appointment with your doctor, you can always go back to your piercer if they are sort of closer to you and you can get to see them sooner, because because although they're not medically trained and they can't actually treat infections, they are trained in doing piercings and identifying complications. So they'll be able to assess it and give you some advice as well. I think an important thing to mention at this point is that if you are treating an infection or you're worried about an infection, it's really important to actually keep the piercing in. Whilst the piercing is there, it is creating that channel that allows the pus and discharge from the area to drain. Whereas if you take the piercing out, because obviously it's very painful and sometimes you get to that restriction because there's not enough space for the ear to expand anymore, then what happens is you risk trapping that infection inside when the skin closes over the top. So if you can and haven't been instructed to, keep the piercing in. So we've just discussed how that is different from just an irritated piercing. Remember that an irritated piercing can just be red and a little bit itchy maybe because there's some swelling going on and have some clear fluid. Now sometimes, especially if the piercing, the sort of bar that's used itself, has nickel in it, it is a metal that a lot of people are actually irritated to. So you might find that in addition to the swelling, you have a lot of itching within that area. So you don't get pus and discharge, you don't feel unwell, your lymph nodes aren't swollen, but it's very itchy and uncomfortable. So it's really important to make sure that the piercings that you get are either done with something like surgical steel or things like titanium. Those are both very inert and very, very unlikely to cause any allergic symptoms. So just to add here about the jewellery that you use for the piercings. So if you are going to get a cartilage piercing, say for example with mine, the helix piercing, it's always a better option to go for a bar with a flat back. Not only does that give the piercing some space to swell as it's healing, but it also, because it's sort of a straight line, it's easier for the piercing to heal rather than getting used to a curved piece that's also at risk of being caught on things like your hair and so on. Whilst we are on the topic of looking after your piercings, I think it's also really important to touch on being able to differentiate between a granuloma and a keloid scar. So a granuloma is usually sort of a fleshy pink swelling that you see right where the piercing itself is, and this usually is a result of an irritation because of the actual piercing itself or the type of jewelry that's been used. And more often or not, this usually presents sort of quite early on from when you have the piercing, and you might notice some clear fluid coming out of it. In comparison to that, a keloid scar is more just flesh colored. And you may be able to tell if you're going to develop a keloid scar from a piercing from past experience, from things like cuts and scrapes that you've had before. If you've developed keloid scars whilst those cuts have been healing, it's a very good indication to say if this bump that you have is a keloid scar or not. But it is usually flesh colored and it comes on a bit later. So I would say after the 3 month mark is when you start noticing this bump, and you won't get any clear fluids coming out of it. And it might actually grow over time from the point that you have that hole for the piercing and get bigger. Now the treatment for this is very different because it's not an irritation site as such. You can have, depending on the size and how bothered you are, you can either just leave it alone. You can decide to take the piercing out completely if you don't want it to risk developing further. But otherwise, the treatments for them are things like steroid injections and also removal surgically, so actually cutting out the scar. But in most cases, this can actually trigger another keloid scar forming in its place. So it's a very tricky one. To treat granulomas, it's a bit of like trial and error. There's no right and wrong, besides some of the wrongs that I'll tell you. But as in, there's no specific sort of scientific research that's gone into any of these methods. So it's a bit of anecdotal things that have worked for people. So one of the things you can try is chamomile tea bag. So if you get a bag of chamomile tea and put it in some sort of hot water, allow it to brew a little bit, just a little bit, so that the hot water actually goes inside, remove the tea bag, squeeze it, check that it's a good temperature to actually apply to your skin, so you might want to check on the back of your hand, and then do a warm compress with that over the granuloma. Sort of hold it there for a few minutes, however long feels comfortable. Also, however long you can be bothered to do it as well. I mean, I'm not gonna say like tape it to your ear and stay with it the whole day, but you might wanna do it a couple of times a day. You also might wanna do something similar with sea salt. So you can put some sea salt in some warm water, get a cotton pad, so not the actual walls, because the fibers can get caught in the piercing and itself cause irritation. So you want to go for the pads, dip it in the water, again make sure that it's the right temperature, and use that to apply some compress over the area. You might also want to try a very mild steroid cream, so you can buy these over the counter. They're called 1% hydrocortisone creams. You can just apply it very thinly to the area, sort of a couple of times a day for a few weeks to see if it makes a difference. You don't really want to be using it for longer than 3 weeks, especially if it's not giving you any benefits. And I think the most important thing to say is to really avoid harsh chemicals. Remember, this granuloma is there because of irritation and just the body's reaction to the piercing. So you don't want to be applying anything like hydrogen peroxide, surgical spirit, rubbing alcohol and tea tree oil and things like that. They are really irritating and drying to the skin, so using them can just make the granuloma worse. And I think I've left the really important advice to the end, and that is side sleeping. So I got two piercings within a week of themselves, because I got this piercing here, which is the mid-helix piercing. And they told me that I shouldn't be sleeping on my side for about 3 months. So I thought, if I'm gonna wait out 3 months and not sleep on my side, I might as well get the other piercing that I wanted in the area, which is this upper helix piercing that got infected, but anyways. So I might as well just have them at the same time so they can heal together. And once I'm done with the healing process, I'm a bit more comfortable with sleeping on my side. I really struggled with not being able to sleep on that one side. And this is the method that has been very helpful. Let me go and get it. So here you go, this has been my lifesaver. I think I read it on one of the threads that suggested sleeping on a travel pillow, and it really does make a difference. So whenever I want to sleep on this side, I actually have this with me in bed now. It's like one of our companions alongside like the rest of the pillows we have in bed. So whenever I want to turn on that side, I kind of wake up, because if I'm turning, then I kind of feel the pain, so that wakes me up slightly. So then I reach out for this pillow, I put it underneath my head, and as you can see, the area that's here kind of hollows out around your ear, so you are able to lie on your side but not actually touch and irritate the piercing. So you can allow it to heal without causing any further irritation overnight. So that's it, guys. I really hope that you enjoyed this video. I have really struggled with this piercing for the past couple of months, but that is my sort of personal experience with cartilage piercings. My tragus piercing particularly took 2 years to fully heal, and now it's completely fine. And even though it gets caught like very rarely, it doesn't react at all. So I think my body's finally accepted that it's there. One other thing that I didn't mention that you can probably do is make sure that you get the right size bar. You want a bar that is long enough to accommodate any swelling when there is irritation. I think that's one of the main reasons why my tragus took so long. When I changed it over to a longer bar and it just gave it some space to do whatever it wanted to do whilst it was healing, it actually got better a lot quicker than the shorter bar, than when the shorter bar was in. That is all my tips and tricks. I really hope that you enjoyed the video. It's given you some insight and something to think about, and something to refer back to when you have a piercing. Share it with your friends if anybody needs to listen to some of the tips and tricks, but also help them differentiate between an infected and an irritated piercing. That being said, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Follow me on Instagram as well, and I will see you in my next video. Bye, guys.